On May 11th, the Aurora Borealis touched down in places as far as Georgia. And some of us were able to actually get a really cool view of the Northern Lights from our hometown, and some of us were able to get it from our smartphones. Sorry, Noah. There is a very good chance that we'll get to see the Northern Lights again, and without having to go as far as Alaska or Iceland. Let's talk a little bit about exactly what that means. Solar storms are caused by coronal mass ejections. We'll call them CMEs. These bands of energy get fired off into space, and when the Earth crosses through the path of one of these storms, that's when we get the highest chance to see the Northern Lights. These solar storms will occur more and more frequently as the sun nears its solar maximum. That's the 11-year cycle on which its poles flip on each other. My excitement about this stems from the fact that it makes us really feel as small as we actually are in the solar system. When I think about how big the universe is, it's sort of incomprehensible. But when you have an event like this, and you can see the effects of things in space, like the solar eclipse, which we made a video about, you can check it out if you want, it really puts into scale just how small we actually are. I'd like to take you back to an earlier solar storm, the Carrington event, which occurred in 1859, and share with you some of the testimonies of people that lived through it.
At 7:30 o'clock, we were notified of a large fire behind the mountain at the north. We went out to see it, and presently the red clouds began to disappear. It was the most magnificent display ever witnessed in this section. The sky, for about an hour or more, kept changing from red to green till 10:30 o'clock, when all the brilliancy was gone, except a little green at the north.
This event shook the world, as many wondered if this was the end of the world. Today, we refer to it as the Carrington event, after Richard Carrington, who first noticed the sunspots in 1859. He used a special brass telescope to see the shifting, boiling surface of the sun, and was able to see and make out differences in the chromosphere, parts of the sun which are usually invisible unless you're in, say, a total solar eclipse. On one such day, he noticed dark spots forming, and within a few minutes, two bright white spots that looked like beans appeared. These spots were multiple times the size of the Earth, and within a few mere minutes, they had vanished. It left Carrington wondering what it is he had seen, but that answer would be soon to follow, as the geomagnetic storms quickly headed towards the Earth would cause the auroras in both the North and Southern hemispheres shortly after. The Carrington event would be the first storm of its kind. You see, solar storms had come before, and they'd given us the Northern Lights in regions that usually don't see them, but it had never caused disruptions or destroyed things. You see, when the Carrington event came through, the early internet, the telegraph machines, started acting up. They started acting funny. Some of them caught on fire. These events would almost always be destructive if not for the Earth's magnetic poles. You see, they act like a sort of force field and tend to push away a lot of these ions and stray particles flying at the Earth. In addition to Earth's natural force field, we've actually gotten better at predicting and studying these sorts of events. The ISS, for example, is able to see them in advance, power down critical motor functions, and make sure that it doesn't get destroyed as one of these solar waves comes through. The astronauts on the ISS actually have to take cover because it's much more dangerous when you're outside of the ionosphere.
I get it, Chris. The sun wants to kill me. You haven't explained why it's pretty. Hold on, I will.
So, as I said before, the electromagnetic radiation sent off from the sun during these CMEs is hurtling towards Earth at an accelerated rate, and when it hits, it travels along the field lines towards the North and South Poles, and that's where it ionizes the air there. Have you ever seen a neon sign? The fluorescent lights are usually some sort of an ionization. When these electromagnetic radiation waves hit the Earth, they ionize the nitrogen and the oxygen and helium and some other elements that are up in the air. The oxygen turns red and green, the nitrogen turns blue and purple, and depending on where it ionizes in the atmosphere, makes a difference on the concentration of those gases and which ones you see illuminating the night sky. The sun is expected to enter its solar maximum in 2025, and as it does, we'll see more and more of these Carrington-like events, hopefully none so aggressive, but we might actually get to see more auroras within the next year. It's also worth noting, as we compare different auroras, that these have occurred and been taking place for a very long time, and because we know that the Romans and Greeks were able to study them, there's a good chance they've reached even further south than Georgia. The name Aurora Borealis is actually given to us by the Romans. You see, they named it after the goddess of the north wind, Boreas, and the goddess Aurora, the dawn. It's also worth noting that it's not just the heavens and your smartphone being affected by these sorts of solar events. Studies have actually shown that animals and humans alike have differences in behavior patterns that correlate with the solar cycles. Birds have been shown to change their mating cycles in accordance with solar activity, and a study in 2006 actually correlated changes in creativity depending on when a child was born in a solar cycle. So where do we go from here? Now that you know all of this, how do you apply it? Why does it matter? I want to encourage you to not just store up knowledge, but to let it change and inform the way that you think about the world. After all, the point of education is to know God and to make Him known. Take the time to sit in awe of God and His creation today. Remember, learning is a lifestyle. Be an everyday educator.